Right. So, hello everyone. Welcome to the PC seminar. Today we have with us Nikolaos Melissinos from University of Paris-Dauphine, and he'll be talking on digraph coloring and distance to acyclicity. So thank you so much for joining us, Nikolaos. Over to you now.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the introduction. Like you said, I will present you digraph coloring and distance to acyclicity, which is a joint work with Ararat Harutyunyan and Mikhail Lambis. And we managed to have an acceptance paper in Stacks, this year's Stacks, with this work. So at first, I will present you the problem and its relation with the classic graph coloring. After that, I will give you some easy and obvious results for our problem. And I will continue with some parameterized results based on the parameters directed feedback vertex set, feedback arc set, and tree width. So in the classic graph coloring, we want to give colors in the vertices such that each two vertices that share an edge, they have different colors. In this triangle, for example, we need three colors, let's say white, black, and gray, in order to have this property, and those colorings are called the proper colorings. However, if we are going to generalize this idea in directed graphs, then we completely ignore the direction of the arcs. For that reason, we decide to discuss about another coloring, another property, where we want the colors to induce a directed acyclic graph. So for this directed cycle here, we can color the vertices with two colors, the two above colors with the color black and the third color with the color white, because now we can see that each color induces a directed acyclic graph. This coloring is a generalization of the classic coloring, because we can force, we have digraphs where they request exactly the same colorings as the underlined graphs by replacing the edges of the graph with diagons, where diagons are two parallel edges with different directions between the same two vertices. This kind of coloring, introduced by Victor Newman Lara in 1982, who specifically introduced the notation of dichromatic number of a digraph, which is the minimum number of colors that we need in order to have such a coloring. Furthermore, one of the motivations for this work is the observation that the dichromatic number, it seems to replicate the behavior of the chromatic number in the field of the digraphs. And it's interesting that we managed to find a counterexample in that observation, which is the behavior based in the parameterized results in the undirected tree width. Okay, so let me try again to include what I said. We are interested in directed graphs, and we want to assign colors in the vertices, and we want each color to induce a directed acyclic graph. Another way to see the same problem is we have a number k, and we want to partition the vertices into k sets such that each set induce a directed acyclic graph. In this case, you can think that each vertex set of the k sets is the vertices that have the same color. Okay, so the exact type of questions we are interested is this one. Is a graph k colorable? For this specific example I have here, is this specific graph too colorable? And if you see a bit, you will realize that because we have at least one diagon, we know that we cannot have a one coloring for this graph. So the minimum number of colors that we need in order to not have a cycle, it's two. And if you check a bit further, you will realize that this graph has a two coloring. We can color the left side, the left part of the graph with one color, the right part of the graph with another color. And each color give us a directed acyclic graph because it's just a path with three vertices. Okay, so now, like I said before, because it seems to have close relation with coloring, it is easy to have some first results. And the most easy one is to see that if we replace the edges of a graph with diagons, then the problem is exactly the same. So because the classic K coloring is NP-hard in graphs with maximum degree K plus one, that this is directly a result for our problem, where it says that, okay, the K digraph coloring is NP-hard in digraphs with maximum degree 2K plus 2. Furthermore, another observation, and actually previous result, is the fact that if the maximum degree is 2K, again, the K is the number of colors we want to use, then the problem is in P, and this is a result by generalization of Brooks' theorem by Moha 2010. Now, because this problem it's related too much with cycles, our idea was to try to discuss about the parameterized complexity of this problem based on parameters that are related to acyclicity. So one such parameter is the directed feedback vertex set. The directed feedback vertex set is a set of vertices in a D graph, which if it will be removed, the remaining graph is acyclic. So again, another easy observation is that if we have a D graph that has directed feedback vertex set of size K, then this D graph is always K plus one colorable, because we can use one color in each vertex of directed feedback vertex set and the remaining color in the rest of the graph, which is acyclic. This last observation motivates more to answer other questions. So we try to answer the question if a D graph with feedback vertex set K is K colorable, because like we said, it's we know that it's K plus one colorable. And here we managed to prove that even in this restricted case, the problem to decide if the graph is K colorable, it's NP-hard. Okay, so we have a dichotomy here where we know that K plus one coloring is easy for D graphs with size K, with graphs with directed feedback vertex set of size K, but it becomes NP-hard if we want to use only K colors. Okay, this theorem is based on a reduction from a restricted version of the result, and I will try to give you the construction for two colors. So I will prove this theorem for two colors. And we will start from the restricted version of FreeSat. In this restricted version, we have instances such that all the clauses contains either only positive or only negative literals. And all the variables appears at most two times positive and one time negative. Furthermore, we allow the clauses to have either three or two literals in the instance. So, starting from such an instance from the SAT, We will create a directed graph, and we will start by, for each clause, we will create a path by alternating some vertices that we will call literal vertices and some connector vertices. So it's a path, for example, if we have x1, x2, x3, then it's a path that starts with a vertex corresponding to x1, a connector vertex, a vertex corresponding to x2, a connector vertex, a vertex corresponding to x3. So this kind of paths. And after creating all those paths, we will add some other paths that connecting all the positive appearance of a variable with all the negative appearance of the same variable. And those paths by passing from another new vertex W prime. So let me give you a small example. We have this formula with the two clothes, one cloth with three literal, another cloth with two literals. For each one of those clothes, we create a path, those horizontal paths, or you can call it clothes paths. The first one is x1, w11, x2, w12, x3. The x's are the literal vertices, the other are the connector vertices. And create the same path similarly for the second clause. And because we have both positive and negative appearance for x1, we will create those, let's say, variable paths, which starting from x1 and ending no x1. For the x2, the same thing, because again, x2 has positive and negative appearance. And we do the same thing for all the clauses and the variables. Okay, so before I continue, I want to say that, okay, this graph until here, it's acyclic. Because if we stay in the same path, obviously, we cannot have cycle because it's not, it doesn't close. And if we move from one close to another, it's always we are leaving a positive appearance and going to a negative appearance. And from the second path, we cannot leave because we didn't add any such arcs. Okay, so we have created an acyclic graph, and now we are going to forcing some colors in this graph by adding a palette in our graph. So for the case with two colors, the palette contains only two new variables connected with diagonals in order to be sure that they will have different colors. And we will connect those two vertices, let's say V1, V2, with the rest of the graph as follows. For each close path, we will create a cycle with V2 by connecting V2 with the starting vertex of this path and returning from the last vertex of this path. And we add diagonals between the connector vertices and V1. We're doing something similar with the variable paths, but instead of V2, the cycle contains V1. So from V1 going to the positive appearance and returning from the negative appearance. And we add diagonals between the connector and the V2 now instead of V1 as before. Okay, so this is the construction. Okay, actually, it's a bit more complicated because those paths are the vertical paths here, but it's easier for the representation. So in order to finish the proof, we need to prove that this graph is two colorable if and only if the starting formula is satisfiable. And I will try to explain, okay, if we have a satisfying assignment for phi, I will try to give you a two coloring for the graph. How? I will give the color white to V1, the color black to V2. I will force the color black to all the W because I have diagonals with V1. All the W prime must have the color white because they have diagonals with V2, and the gray vertices are the literal vertices, And now for those vertices, I will decide based on the truth assignment. If the corresponding literal is true, then I am coloring this vertex with the color white. If the corresponding literal is false, then I'm coloring this vertex with the color black. Now, we can see that this is a proper coloring. Why? Because all those cycles that passing from one specific close, they have at least one white vertex because each close has at least one true literal. And all the vertical cycles passing from the variable paths, they must contain at least one black vertex because they are passing from xj and no xj, and obviously one of the two must be false. Okay, and it's not hard to see that if we are using the vertical, we're moving from one close to another, then we're passing from different color vertices, and we don't have monochromatic cycles in that case. So now let's assume that we have a two coloring, and I will try to find a truth assignment, and assume that in this two coloring, the V1 is white and the V2 is black. Again, the W's must be black because they have diagonals with V1. The W primes must be white because they have diagonals with V2. And now we will decide the truth assignment based on the white vertices of the vertex literals, the literal vertices. So if we have a white vertex, then we are taking the corresponding literal and we give value in order to make this literal true. So if it's positive appearance, the variable must be true. If it's negative appearance, then the variable must be false in order for the literal to be true. Now, why we don't have problems such that we want one variable to be in the same time true and false? This happens because of those cycles here, because in that case, both of those vertices must be white in order to force such a thing. And then we would have a white cycle, which is impossible because we don't want monochromatic cycles. Okay, and the second question is why we are satisfying all the closes. And the answer is from the other side, because if we have a close that is not satisfied, that means that all the literals there are false. That means that all the variables have the same value, but it's coming from here that all those vertices are black. So we have again a monochromatic cycle, which is impossible. So this two coloring produces a satisfying assignment. Okay, now the question is how we can generalize this for K colors. And it's easy to do that because we keep exactly the same proof, but we just add extra vertices and connect them with every existing vertices with diagonals. So we are forcing a new color. So the same exactly proof by just adding those vertices. Okay, because this is not really, it's MP hard, we try to see what happens if we restrict more our instances. So we try to do something similar with bounded feedback vertex set and bounded degree, because as you can see here, we have had too many diagons, so the degree here seems huge. Okay, in order to bound the degree, we will change the palette, obviously, and we will try to create some big paths, monochromatic paths, in order to avoid those diagons by using many vertices of those paths. Okay, so the construction here starts with some small paths with three vertices for those paths, as many as the color we want. And for each two colors, we assume that we have an ordering of the colors. So we create this kind of graph between the two paths we have created for those two colors. Now, it's not hard to see that this graph has a small, much smaller degree than before. And we will try to add rows in the end in order to have enough vertices in order to not increasing the degree. So if we add this kind of structure in the end, after each row, we add another row, another row, another row, and as many rows as we want, we keep the degree of this palette really small, and we will have enough vertices in order to not increase the degree by adding the rest of the graph. And we can force all the colors we want. So based on this new palette, we managed to prove that if you count correctly the degrees, you can see that this graph has a directed feedback vertex set of size k and maximum degree for k minus 1. And the problem remains NP-hard even in this case. However, if we further reduce the maximum degree to 4k minus 3, then the problem becomes tractable. More specifically, this digraph with feedback vertex set k and maximum degree 4k minus 3, it's k colorable if and only if the induced graph that's induced by the close neighborhood of the directed feedback vertex set is k colorable. And like I said, the NP hardness is based in the new palette, but the second result is based that if we can have a k-coloring for the Claes neighborhood of F, we prove that we can modify this coloring and extend it to the whole graph. Similarly, instead of the degree, we're counting the feedback arc set in the previous palette, and we saw that this counting give us a feedback arc set now of size k square. So the same results is for graphs with feedback arc set k square and maximum degree of using the same, because we didn't change anything. So the problem even there, it's NP-hard, and again we managed to solve if we decrease the feedback arc set by one now. So if the size of the feedback arc set is k square minus one, then the problem again becomes tractable. And more specifically, it's k colorable if and only if the graph induced by the vertices that are incident in the arcs of the feedback arc set, it's k colorable. So now, This last result is can be proved by induction to the number of colors. Okay, so we have two interesting dichotomies here. First, for the directed feedback vertex set, we, like I said before, we proved that if we have size k of a directed feedback vertex set, then it's always k plus one colorable, and it's NP hard to decide if it's k colorable. And here with the feedback arc set, if we have feedback arc set k square, then the problem is the k coloring is NP hard. But if we're going to k square minus one, the problem becomes tractable. Okay, however, as you can see, most of those results are hardness results, and we need to go to very restricted cases in order to have some tractability or some decidability. So we started to considering other parameters related to the distance of the acyclicity. And more specifically, we tried to decide about the trig width of the underlined graph. Here, we managed to prove that the problem becomes tractable. And more specifically, we can have an algorithm that decides if a graph is k-colorable in k to the power of 3 width times 3 width factorial times a polynomial of n. If the 3 width obviously is bounded. So, and this result is by using the classic dynamic techniques, dynamic programming techniques on the 3D composition. And at last we have a result that give us that the problem is tractable. However, this parameter seems really huge, the k to the power of 3 width times 3 width factorial. So let me try to explain a bit how we end up with this complexity. The idea is that because we have paths and we don't have only the edges and two vertices have different colors of the certain edge, now we need to remember the paths between the same colored vertices. So for each node of the 3D composition, it's not enough to keep a coloring, but we need to keep information about the paths, the paths that exist in the part of the graph we have forgotten or we haven't seen yet, etc. So we keep a coloring and a topological ordering of the vertices of the node B. So like I said, why we need this topological ordering? Using this topological ordering, we can have information about the paths and we can reject some colorings or maybe some orderings for specific colorings and keep only the valid colorings and more specifically in the introduce and the join nodes. For example, in the introduce nodes, we can see that if the new vertex has a backward arc, then it shouldn't be in that position because it would create cycle. Similarly, in the join nodes, we can check the orderings and we can keep only the coloring and the orderings that share the same thing. Okay, so finally, we end up with the complexity I said because the colorings are bounded by k to the power of 3 width, while the orderings are obviously bounded by 3 width factorial. So the dependence parameter is k to the power of 3 width times 3 width factorial. Okay, so now, like I said, this seems really bad. And why this is seems really bad? Because we started by the observation that the dichromatic number and the chromatic number seems to have similar behavior. And in the classic graph coloring, we know that the same algorithm runs in, it has a dependence parameter k to the power of 3 width, which is much less than ours. So the question here is, can we further reduce the running time of this algorithm? The answer is no, because we managed to prove that even if we consider more strict parameters like the tree depth, then if there exists an algorithm that decides if a digraph is too colorable in tree depth to the power of small o of tree depth times a polynomial of n, then the exponential time hypothesis is false. And we don't really believe that the exponential time hypothesis is false, but okay. So this proof, obviously, it's related to the three shot. And the idea for this proof is that we're starting from threesat and creating a graph with too many vertices and bounded tree depth. we're gonna prove that this this graph is too colorable if and only if the formula is satisfiable. And you can observe that if we replace the values of tree depth in the previous running time, then the exponential time hypothesis is false. Now, I will try to give you the construction for this proof. Okay, so like I said, we will start from a formula for three sat. In this formula, we have a set of vertices, and we will partition this set of vertices in log n sets, independent sets, that disjoint sets, with almost the same number of variables in them. And for each one of them, of the sets, xi, we will create a set of vertices. I will not go in details, but it has a lot of vertices. We will need a lot of vertices. After creating all those vertices, we add a universal vertex and connect all of those vertices with this universal vertex v, u. So we have this kind of construction until now. So for each one of those sets x1, xk, we have create a set of vertices v1, vk, and we have connect all of the vertices with u. So after that, for each set of, variables xi, and each truth assignment on that set of variables, we define arbitrarily an ordering. And for each different assignment, we have a different ordering. And that's why I said that we need a lot of vertices. We want all the possible orderings to be more than the possible assignments. Okay, so now what we are doing, based on each set xi and each clove, if a truth assignment sigma satisfies this clove, then we create a new set of vertices s ij sigma based on those parameters, and we create a path that use alternatively vertices from the vi and the new set of vertices, and it respects the ordering that we have defined for this sigma. So what does this mean? Let's say that we have the vertices of vi in this ordering, rho sigma, then we are leaving the first vertex, going to one of the vertices of the S, and going back and do this path alternatively. Okay, so in order to complete the proof, the construction, we will create some cycles for the closes. So for each close, we keep all the sets S related for this specific close. So if we have the set, the close CJ, we'll keep all the sets S that have J as second parameter, and create cycles by adding some connecting vertices. How? Let's say that we have all those sets in an order. Between them, we add the connecting vertices, and we add all the vertices of one set, they connect into the P, and from P we connect into all the vertices of the second set, and we have another P, and this way we create a cycle. Finally, those P's are connected with diagons with some vertices of V1. Now, I am claiming that this construction it's too colorable if and only if the starting formula is satisfied. So let me argue about that, and let's assume that we have a truth assignment for the formula, a satisfying assignment for the formula. And I will present you a way to give a two coloring for this graph. So I am starting by giving colors a bit arbitrarily. So I'm giving the color one to the vertices, to all the vertices in the sense Vi. And because of that, I need to give the color two in the U. And similarly, the P vertices, because they're connected with V1, must have the color two. And now I need to decide the colors for the sets S, the vertices on the sets S. How I'm going to decide those? For each close CJ, there exists at least one set XI that satisfies this close under the truth assignment C, because this is a satisfying assignment for the formula. So I select the set S I J sigma prime, where sigma prime is the sigma restricted to the XI, because that's how we created those sets based on those assignments. And we are giving to that set the color one. And we're doing this for each close. And for the rest of the sets of the vertices, we're going to give the color two. And now I'm claiming that this is a proper two coloring because we respect the ordering I'm saying here. So let me try to explain why, what I mean with that. Okay, first, all of those cycles have one set S colored with the color one, and all the others are color two. So I don't have problems with this. And this happens because, like I said, I'm doing this for each close. So all of those cycles has at least one such a set. Now, the problem is that for those sets, maybe we have two such a sets, let's say Si J sigma and Si J prime sigma, sigma prime, which are all colored with one, and all of them connecting with the same Vi. So the problem, it may be that we may have such cycles. However, like I said, the ordering is the key in order to be sure that we will not have such a cycle. What does it mean? It means that this sigma, it must be always the same because it's the restricted, is the truth assignment we had for the formula restricted to the Vi. So we know that all of those sigmas have the same I and sigma. And because for this sigma, we have a specific ordering, we know that all of those paths keep the same ordering. That means that we cannot have cycles in these vertices. So we don't have cycles based on these cycles. We don't have cycles based on those sets. So we cannot have cycles. And the other two colored vertex was the U, but it's not connected with any of those things. So we don't care. Now I need to prove the reverse, that if I have a two coloring for my graph, then I can prove that there exists a satisfying assignment for the formula. So without loss of generality, I assume that I have a two coloring and that the universal vertex U, it's colored with the color two. Because we have those diagonals with all the vertices of the sets Vi, we need the Vi to be colored all with one. Now, some other observations here is that all the pieces must be colored two because they have diagonals with the V1. And now we need to observe that it must exist for each close, it must exist at least one set Sij sigma that has all its vertices colored with one. So why this happens? Because we have these cycles. Like I said, all the piece must be colored as black, as two. So because all of those are two, then if all the sets has at least one vertex colored with two, then we can pass from all of those vertices and create a monochromatic set. So we don't want that. So there exists at least one set that is colored, all the set colored white, again, white, one. So based on this set, we will decide the satisfying assignment. How? Based on the assignment that we have defined, this sigma here. This sigma here, it will give us the assignment for the set I. And even if we don't have for all the vertices, that if we don't have for all the vertices, that means that those vertices doesn't have any effect. We can give them either false or true. Okay, so we need to explain why we cannot have two different assignments for the same set Xi. So returning again here, in order to have two different assignments for this specific set, that means that we have selected two different sets S I with two different sigma. However, because for each one of those sigmas, we have a different ordering of the vertices VI, if we have two of those sets colored with one, then we will have a cycle colored with one. So this is not possible. Thus, all of those sets must have either the same sigma or something different I. So we will not have such a problem. Okay, I think that I finished with this. Okay, yeah, and like I said here again, because we respect the ordering, that's why we don't have any problems. Okay, so we managed to prove that this is too colorable, if and only if the formula is satisfiable. Okay, I don't know how much time I have spent. I think that I ran too much because I think that I am in conclusion. Let me conclude. We managed to prove that if we have bounded directed feedback vertex set of size K, then the K coloring, the K Digraph coloring is NP-hard, even in the case that the maximum degree goes to 4K minus one. And the same thing holds if we have feedback arc set of K of size K square and maximum degree 4K minus one. And the problem becomes tractable if we further reduce the degree in 4K minus three in the case of bounded feedback vertex set. And in the case of the feedback arc set, if we reduce the feedback arc set to K square minus one. Finally, we managed to show that we have an algorithm for graphs with bounded tree width, undirected tree width, which has dependence parameter K to the power of tree width times tree width factorial. And that this is seems inevitable because even the two coloring, if there exists an algorithm that solves it in tree depth to the power of small of tree depths time a polynomial of n, then the exponential time hypothesis is false. So let me close with some open questions. First of all, it would be interesting to see what happens for other undirected structural parameters, maybe like click width. It would be interesting to see what happens to the tractability threshold for other values of the directed feedback vertex set, because like I said in the start, the problem is in P when we have unbounded directed feedback vertex set and the maximum degree is 2k, then the problem is in P and becomes NP if the maximum degree is 2k plus 2. However, if we decrease the bound for the feedback vertex set, we saw that the tractability changed somewhere near to 4k minus 3 from NP hard to become tractable. In the end, it could be interesting to see some if we can find some results on oriented graphs where the oriented graphs are directed graphs without diagons. So if you have two arcs between two vertices, it's only one direction, not both directions. Thank you very much.
All right.
I think I finished a bit too fast. I don't have clock in front of me.
that's fine. You are on time. It's all
okay.
Okay. Yeah. So thank you so much for the talk. It was.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Yeah. So I guess we have some time for questions. So if somebody has questions, they can either type in the chat or maybe even better just unmute and ask.
What happens on tournament? Does the problem become easy?
For tournaments, the question is what would be the problem, the complexity of the problem in tournaments?
That's a good question because as far as I know, we are not entirely sure about the size of the feedback vertex set in the tournaments. We have some upper bounds. So I don't know if we can say something specific from parameterized point of view, but we had to consider a bit the tournaments, and we managed to prove that there exists an algorithm that it's how much it was. It was exponential. It was. Less than 3 to the power of n, but we couldn't find something much more interesting. We couldn't make the problem easier. So I don't know if I cover what you want to hear.
Yeah, okay, thanks. Because you said tournaments, so oriented graph, so even more special would be tournament. Yeah, okay.
I cannot really hear. It's a bit low.
Yeah, I think you answered the question.
Okay.
Yeah. Any more questions?
May I ask one?
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you for the nice talk. To ask which of these results you mentioned in the beginning that. Undirected coloring, K-coloring, reduces to this one. So this means that...
you talk about...
yes, right.
And not here. Here. No?
Well, no, I mean, maybe the first or second slide where you showed that undirected, the undirected problem reduces to the digraph coloring, right?
Yeah.
So how do results, known results for undirected coloring compare to your results?
Yeah. First, the first thing I said it was that that's why I went here because I said that if we replace the edges with diagons, then we can see directly that. We have the NP hardness from k plus 1 to 2k plus 2, the maximum degree. But I'm not sure about the results specifically for the feedback vertex set, for example. I'm not sure because it's completely different. It's in the classic coloring, we don't really care about the cycles, so it's really different, the results.
Okay, and what about the positive results? So do we already
really different. It's start to becomes really different when we're going to diagnose, and the problem becomes much more harder. So I don't think that we can generalize any classic results of based on the coloring. Only the hardness that seems to passing easy.
Okay, thank you.
No problem.
All right, any more questions? Okay, so I suppose not. I don't see anybody unmuted and there's nothing in the chat. All right then, I guess we can conclude. So thank you so much once again for the talk. It was
very thank you again for the opportunity.
Okay, sure. And yeah, thanks to the audience for being around. Now we conclude our session for today here and see you all next week. Thank you, bye.
Bye.